Wonderful, wonderful. You're a great voice. Have you enjoyed the day?
Yes.
Who went to the beach this afternoon? I can tell by the hairstyles. I'm blown away. Wouldn't it be wonderful? Three Salvation Army bands along the seafront of Puerto Rico this afternoon. Isn't that wonderful? Yeah. It's great to hear them. Have we got any Salvations from Bob Naredes in there? Hallelujah. Good to see you. We hope you enjoyed the participation that we were able to bring, that it's raised a sort of profile for the Salvation Army in our and pray that people will see something of the Lord in what we do, don't we? Thank you for participating in such a wonderful way. Well, the band have been working hard this afternoon. And they're going to work hard again this evening. That's good, isn't it? I'm very pleased that Butlin's band has got together in such a short space of time. They're going to bring up the march to us to commence our worship this evening. A good old Salvation Army march called the Wellingtonian. But you're ready to be participate, because towards the end of this piece of music, there's a little melody that comes in twice. And we're going to sing the words to it, which I know you'll know, My Jesus, I Love Thee. They'll come up on the screen. It's the first and the last verses. The last verse says, in mansions of glory and endless delight. Back to the future? Back to the future? Looking to see what God is going to do. Let's enjoy the band, but then be ready to sing. I have to watch the bandmaster's back to bring us in. Thank you, God. That's an now experience, isn't it? Something we want to share because Jesus loves us and we've never loved him. It's good. I want to thank you for Buckingham's Band for bringing to us that stirring moment. You've lifted our spirits and you know that we're in the presence of God. The reading of Scripture, Isaiah 35, that we shared this morning, is the sort of overarching theme that we wanted to share today. Back to the future. A sense of coming back and starting again, as it were, an opportunity to work forward to the future. We invite you for a few moments to be quiet, to listen to this word, the words of the Scripture again, and keep your eye on some pictures which we hope will help to give you that sense of the beauty and glory of the return of the redeemed heaven. Isaiah 35.
The desert and parched land will be glad. The wilderness will rejoice and blossom. Like the crocus, it will burst into bloom. It will rejoice greatly and shout for joy. The glory of Lebanon will be given to it, the splendor of Carmel and Sharon. They will see the glory of the Lord, the splendor of our God. Strengthen the feeble hands. Steady the knees that give way. Say to those with fearful hearts, be strong. Do not fear. Your God will come. He will come with vengeance, with divine retribution. He will come to save you. Then the eyes of the blind will be opened, and the ears of the deaf unstopped. Then will the lame leap like a deer, and the mute tongue shout for joy. Water will gush forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert. The burning sand will become a pool, the thirsty ground bubbling springs. In the haunts where jackals once lay, grass and reeds and papyrus will grow. And a highway will be there. It will be called the Way of Holiness. The unclean will not journey on it. It will be for those who walk in that way. Wicked fools will not go about on it. No lion will be there, nor will any ferocious beast get up onto it. They will not be found there. But only the redeemed will walk there, and the redeemed of the Lord will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads. Gladness and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away.
I'm a soldier bound for glory. Back to the Future. Back to the Future. I'm a soldier bound for glory, but we're going to sing it to the tune which is When the World is Called Up Yonder, I'll Be There. It's another Back to the Future tune, you understand? I'm thinking you'll find it will fit beautifully, but you have to be careful because you fall into a trap of going into the normal chorus when you get to it. So we change the word just a fraction, added a word here and there to the chorus when we get to it, and you'll see it will fit beautifully. Will you experiment with me? You'll enjoy it, I'm sure. Let's sing for three verses. We're going to stand together, if you can. If you're able, if you'd like to stand, let's stand and we'll sing this song. Thank you, Matt. Congregation, he's with us and loves us too. Do you believe it? I love it. love Jesus. Hallelujah. Well, thank you for sharing it in the way that you responded. It's more than we want, it's more than we're able to share in our worship. And we're going to invite you to do the same again, show how much you love the Lord by giving in an offering. And listen to some music as the offering. Don't let that music, some music from over here. Can't help it. Take out the offering as Mike plays us some music, as the band helped us in that way. And then I'm pleased to be able to hand over to
Savior. May that happen tonight, we pray. May someone step forward. in faith, saying, I put my trust in Christ for all the days to come. In his strong name we pray, as we say to him, Our Father, who art in heaven,
Thank you.
Shall we boogie woogie now? Now, I want to know if anybody is here from the South West Division. Yes. Anybody here from Cornwall? Yeah. Anybody here from Lawrence? Or Lancet, as they call it down there. That's up to them how they pronounce it, I don't mind. No? We were blessed to be down there and to get through to Moscow someday. And Majors Gene and Clifford Bradbury made sure that we got to Moscow and saw what was going on there. And I just want to say tonight to this lovely army congregation how proud we can be of the part the army was playing in that place. And I felt 10 feet tall. You know, there are some moments that just come to you and you're just so proud to be in the army. And as we met the people staffing the emergency vehicle and distributing bacon buckets and hot tea. There's nothing like an army cup of tea. It's still true. That should be our 12th doctrine. we'll arrange it. And of course it's all free, and there was this huge mountain of Mars bars. And you could just walk up if you were a victim. I tried to pretend, but I couldn't. You get a free Mars bar. Or if you're an emergency worker, you get a free Mars bar. Speaking to the fire people and the ambulance people and the police, they were just glowing. Thank God for that. And I want you to know that I had an experience that's never happened to me before while I was in breast cancer. I met a witch. Because the division commander said to me, TC, you should come over here where our vehicle is now standing. The vehicle was at first right in the center of the town, right adjacent to the bridge. You know, the bridge and the parapet that got washed away. And but they needed that area as a turning circle, and so after a few days the army just moved its vehicle onto the driveway of a house that was positioned higher up and had not been affected by the water. The house is lower down. You could see the water, the tide mark was right above the lintel of the door. Dreadful, dreadful devastation. It's just a mercy that there was no loss of life. The emergency services were just so relieved about that. But they said, this house where our vehicle is belongs to the local witch. I thought they were winding me up, as people do sometimes. You know, fresh back from New Zealand, Fiji, and Tonga. What does he know? So they said, come and meet her. So I thought, okay. I'm a trained person. I've been to the training college. You know, I can do this. And anyway, Helen wasn't far behind me. But she was behind me. And we went up to the gate, and there's a nice lady. That blonde hair. I don't think it was me. And she was very attractive. And I thought, should I talk to this lady? Because Helen's not got here yet. And what will people think? Anyway, I found myself shaking hands with her, and I said, as one does, are you a witch? And this is absolutely true. I mean, I thought, let's just go for this. Are you a witch? How do you do? And she said, yes, I am. So I said, are you a good witch or a bad witch? Or a sandwich. That's it. She said, no, you're doing the sandwich. I'm a good witch, she said. I said, oh, very relieved. Okay. And I thanked her nicely for allowing us to park the van on the driveway. And then she said to me, are you a Salvation Army officer? I said, yes. Yeah. She said, are you a good one or a bad one? So I said, have a sandwich. Now, most of that is true, okay? Not all, but some of it's true. Richard, you'll vouch for that. He was there. Okay. I didn't see the wizard around though, so I couldn't get back. Now, look, we're going to hear the scriptures, and it's going to be brought to us by the entertainment. And they're going to be portraying to us 1 Samuel chapter 17, verses 1 to 11. And this is about a good little facing a nasty bill. Okay?
And in football, one result from the Premiership, Norwich 3, Tottenham Hotspur 0. And now, over to our foreign correspondent, Kate Wiles in the Middle East, with news of the latest Clash of the Titans. Are you there, Kate?
Yes, thank you, Keith. You join me in Soca for the latest development in the battle between the Philistines and the Israelites. The two sides are lined up either side of the Valley of Elah, and the tension is mounting. At the latest press conference, the Philistines have brought out their latest signing, Goliath. And what a man he is! Here at Bucklands BC, we have been given special access to this incredible specimen of manhood. Standing over 9 feet tall and arrayed in bronze armor, he certainly makes an impression. Goliath, what have you to say to any Israelites listening today?
Thank you, Kate. I'm a Philistine, you slate of Saul. Choose one of your men to fight me. If he wins and kills me, we will be your slaves. But if I win and kill him, you will be our slaves. Here and now I challenge the Israelite army. I dare you to pick someone to fight me.
We understand from the Israelite camp that Saul and his men are absolutely terrified. The outcome of this battle, God only knows. This is Kate Wiles reporting for the Middle East. Full of Bucklands, BC.
Our son John came with us, and he's still over there in New Zealand. He's lived in all those countries with us too, but God's been good to him because God opened up the way for him to participate in different ways and have many friends, and he always sheds tears when he leaves any place, but he knows that the Lord will provide friends in the next place. When we went to Wellington, after whom that piece of music was named, he sat back for a while, he enjoyed sitting with his friends, but he didn't pick up an instrument to play in the band, because it was very different. In the bands in Lahore, in Pakistan, they played hymn tunes loud and clear, and he certainly had good puff, because when they had their commissioning, and or welcome to cadets, sporty cadets would file in and the band would play Lift Up the Banner a number of times, slowly as the cadets came in. So he had some skill of how to play. He'd learned to play and become a junior soldier in Middlesbrough, on Teesside. But when we went to Wellington, it was very different. They were playing this fancy stuff and he didn't feel that he really wanted to do that. So he sat with his friends and was made very welcome. On Sunday night, we were sitting behind the band because they went up in kind of steps. And he must have been looking at the bass section, which there were five members, I think. And on the way home, he said to me, "I've been thinking, I'd like to learn to play an E-flat bass." Well, that was a bit different from the calling, but I said to him, "Well, are you serious?" And he said, "Yes, I think I am." So I said, "Go and speak to the bandmaster." And he did, and to cut the long story short, a bass was found, and he became bass player number six. And just sat in the middle of these players who were really good and competent, but they were so patient with him and just made him feel one of the fellowship. So I just thanked God for that again, because God had gone before and prepared a place for him to participate. It's just wonderful when our young people can find some niche, whether it's in the worship band or the chorus or in the band or just whatever way they can in the core, to find something that's their niche and their thing to do. And we really pray too that along with the music skills that they get, the timbals or those other things, they also learn faith skills, so they will be able to share their faith, because they're on the front line. We've often thought when we go from face to face, we know exactly why we're there, and so do all our colleagues, but when our children go into school, they're on their own. We can't go with them, and they need to witness there. There's a great need for Christian young people, Christian teachers who are going to share the word of God with those who need it so much. I'd like to share a favourite verse of scripture with you. Having been around the world like that, this verse is very precious to me. And also because I'm very conscious of the International Salvation Army and how we're one family and how we behave in one part affects the other part. And we really want to stand with those who are suffering in other countries. I know many of you have missionary hearts, and I've heard some of the stories, the way in which you support and pray for missions and for Christian brothers and sisters in other lands. And so we want to support, and we want to stand alongside those people. And I really love this verse from Revelation chapter 7, verse 9, because this really is to the future. It's where we are going. And people sometimes say, what will the Salvation Army look like in 10 years' time or 100 years' time? Well, I have one picture in my mind that I always keep as a goal, and it's this from Revelation 7. After this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one can count. From every nation, tribe, people and language, standing before the throne and in front of the Lamb, wearing white robes and holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God. He sits on the throne and to the Lamb." That's back to the future. That's where we're aiming, to go back to heaven and back to God. But we have to take a lot of people with us, and we really need God's strength as we reach out. There's a great mission field on our doorsteps. You know that the whole world now is in the cities and the towns of the UK and Ireland. And we really need God's wisdom and God's inspiration to reach out to those people and to bring them from every nation, tribe, people and language into his kingdom. so that we might stand before the throne with that great harvest of souls. God bless you all. Thank you for fellowship. And may you have a great week and an even greater return to your call and your place of work. Amen.
Now, in a few minutes, you're going to have a chance to give us your testimony. No long-winded testimonies tonight, please. Same verse when you get back to the floor. And just be up to date and to the point and concise. And we're going to have a couple of folk, I think Majors Mike and Wendy, a couple are going to be going around us and mics, and you just draw their attention or stand up or something like that, and they'll come to you. But before that, we've got an extra special treat, because the New Horizons staff team, no expense spared, are going to sing for us. Now, I've been told that this is entirely unrehearsed. Right, so will you be sympathetic? I think we should clap before we hear it, okay? Let's give them a hand.
Thank you.
goes with the air. Sopranos. So I hope after that you're ready to give us your testimony. Wave at me if you want to give us your testimony. You've got 15 seconds each when... Okay, go for it. First come, first serve. Over there.
About 2 years ago, I invited a friend from work to come to the album. Recently, she's made an appearance, and today as I left the meeting this morning, I got a text from my CEO to say not only had she gone to the army on her own, which is the first time, but she's also stood up and given her testimony.
That's lovely, isn't it? Give her all up. Come back, please. When you see her. Now, who's somewhere over here? Yes, sir.
Tonight, it's the easy as that. You tell Jesus, I believe in you.
Thank you for that strongest. Praise God for your God that you got saved all those years ago and that he's kept you ever since. Thank you for telling us. Who's next, please? Yes, over there.
I've got one here.
But he's done it twice, so I need to try too. I'd like to say I was first gave my heart to Jesus when I was 7 years old, and we went away during the war to Chester, and it was in Chester that I first gave my heart to Jesus. And then at St. Peter Port, I was made a senior soldier with 13 other people. And I'm now the Home League Secretary at Lille, and I'm glad that the Lord has given me a work for him to do. We did used to go to the Home League with my mother, and I'm one of the twin, and they used to sing, joy, 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 there is joy in the Salvation Army. And I turned to my mother and said, and Margaret too. And I'm glad that Margaret too is still serving the Lord today.
Now, there's a gentleman with his hand up in the middle there. Is anybody on my left?
Yeah. Here. Hi.
Yes, go for it. Whoever's got a mic, just go for it.
I would just like to say that this time last year, I went to Pontins.
Let's take a bit of a box. Signs of encouragement coming to you. God bless you and your dear.
went really, really well, and he thanked us for their prayers.
Lovely, thank you. Isn't that good news? God bless the poor and they. There'll be many more coming to faith and interactive on the service. So we've got time for two more. Don't miss out. Here's a hand down here near the aisle. Major Wendy, thank you. And there's one right over here too. One over here. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you again for blessing us with your voices and your singing. It's been an inspiration today, a very distinctive part of our two meetings in here. I was struck by many of those who spoke to us briefly just now, by their courage. You know, we're gathered and some of us do know each other and we know what's going on in each other's lives, but most of us don't know what's going on in each other's lives in this gathering. And some of us are carrying tremendous burdens in our personal circumstances. And some of you have described some of those circumstances tonight. It reminds us not to be blasé about those around us. Let's get closer to the people for the sake of Christ and discover their circumstances and pray them through and befriend them and love them through. I get upset when I hear the unbeliever and sometimes the chattering classes. Do you know what I mean by the chattering classes? The trendy ones, the chattering classes. The TV commentators, the sophisticates, who try and tell us from time to time that religion is the opium of the people, or it's just an escape, or you know, it's for the feeble-minded. I just don't understand that. Well, they just don't understand it, do they? It takes courage to belong to Christ. Especially in this day and age, but it's never been easy. And the history of the proclamation of the gospel is littered with cases of outstanding courage. And I want to speak to you tonight about courage. And I want to encourage you. Encourage you. Put courage into you. That's what the word to encourage. Encouragement means. When we read the scriptures, we're encouraged, we're fortified, built up again, we get new heart. And we'll start by going to the newscast that was shared with us so skillfully about the confrontation between the Israelites and the Philistines. And it's 1 Samuel 17, and we are looking and the Israelites lined up for battle on the top of a valley slope, and across the valley at the top of the other upward slope are the Philistines. And the Philistines send out Goliath to strike fear into the heart of the Israelites, and the tactic works. Because Goliath says, is there anyone who will come and challenge me? And nobody does. Now, our interest is in David. He wasn't there when this happened, but all his big brothers were. He was too young to be sent into the forces of his people, and he was at home looking after the sheep. He'd also done some musical performances for King Saul. In fact, he played the lyre at the court of Saul. And the scriptures tell us that from time to time, Saul would get depressed. And when that happened, they would send for David, the son of Jesse, to come and soothe him and encourage the king with music. The power of music is sometimes unsurpassed. It can communicate and reach places that the spoken word sometimes fails to reach. Now, David hears about Goliath. This is how it happened. Goliath stood. Now, I want to check out the facts here. Right, here it is. 6 cubits plus a span. That's 10 feet. Have you ever seen anybody 10 feet tall? Who's the tallest person you've ever seen? Yeah, have you seen some of these American basketball players? Very tall. We had a very famous woman, netball People actually pay money to go and watch it. I met them both. And they actually televise live netball. And there'll be a crowd of 6,000 or 8,000 people who paid money to go in and watch it. And they attract international players from other parts of the world. And the New Zealand, what are they called? The Silver Ferns is the Kiwi netball, women's netball. Well, they only have a women's netball team. I don't think they've got a men's netball team. But Irene van Dijk was recruited. She came over to New Zealand from South Africa. And we were having Congress gatherings with General and Mrs. Galvinson. And we asked Irene to come along and be interviewed and give her testimony, because she's a really strongly believing Christian woman. She gave a lovely testimony. But afterwards, we were hosting her lunch, and we were just standing around, and she was very natural and easy company. And she was wearing, you know, her tracksuit, the official tracksuit of the team. And then she just stretched, and she put up her hands and put them on the ceiling, and just pressed upward on the ceiling. And I stood there, said, "How's it going?" "Do you want to come down now?" Now, she wasn't 10 feet, but she was incredibly tall, but very elegant with it. I'm not saying Goliath was elegant, but he's incredibly tall. And he had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat of armor was 5,000 shekels of bronze. That's 150 pounds weight, just the armor that he wore. And he had bronze armor on his legs, and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders, and the shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, it says in the scripture here. And his spear's head, just the head of the spear, weighed 600 shekels of iron. That's about 18 to 20 pounds weight, just the head of the javelin. And his shield bearer went before him. Now, Jesse said to David, "You've got to take some sandwiches up to your brothers who are fighting the Philistines. Please take some sandwiches. And here's some special cheese. And I want you to take it to the territorial commander of the army." Okay? "Because I want him to look after your brothers. And please give him the cheese and all will be well. And he won't put them into the front line of the battle." Well, meanwhile, Goliath's out there every day challenging, challenging. He says, "Choose a man and let him come down to me. If he's able to fight with me and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants." So there's a lot at stake. "I defy the ranks of Israel this day." And the scripture records that the Israelites, when they heard these words, were greatly dismayed and greatly afraid. Now, David turns up in the camp of the Israelites and hears the gauntlet, you know, the challenge thrown down by Goliath. And he goes around, little David goes around, saying, "Who's he? What's all this about? And which one of you is going to, you know, go and front up to this man?" And he quickly perceives that nobody's willing to step forward. Now, I don't know what you would have done, or what I would have done. It's like this morning all over again, isn't it? When we're challenged, what would we do? When things are difficult, what would we do? Where does our courage go? And where can we find fresh courage from in moments like that? Well, they took the boy, because he was asking pertinent questions, they took him before the king. And Saul said to David, "You're not able to go out against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth. And he has been a man of war, for many years." And that reminded me of young Amar Khan, you know, the boxer at the Olympics, 17 years of age, taking on grown men. And he worked for them. And he nearly dealt with, you know, the 34-year-old Olympic champion in the final bout there, but didn't quite make it. Well, this story has a different kind of ending. And here's the boy. And he says, "Look, I've had many difficult encounters, O king, with lions and bears looking after my father's sheep. So I'm accustomed to danger." Okay? "And when a lion or bear comes and takes a lamb from the flock, I go after him and I smite him and I deliver the lamb out of his mouth." now. David said, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and the Lord be with you. I think Saul was glad that anybody would go. But his trust is in the Lord. Then Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a helmet of bronze on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. And David girded his sword over his armor. And he tried in vain to go, for he was not used to them. They were too heavy. He couldn't walk. Right, so it all comes off. I cannot go with these, said David, for I'm not used to them. And David put them off. Don't borrow anybody else's spiritual armor when you're up for a tough encounter. You've got to have your experience of Christ. You cannot rely on your spouse's experience of Christ in such a situation, or your child's, or your parents'. It's got to be your experience, your armor, your weapons supplied by God directly to you. David puts off other people's accoutrements. Then it says here in Scripture, he took his staff in his hand and he went down to the brook and chose how many? 5 smooth stones. All right. Now, you've all been to the sea, haven't you? Did anybody go down to the edge of the water this afternoon and find a flat stone and start spinning them? Too round. These pebbles on those beaches are too round. But who skimmed stones across the water, across the lake, across the sea? Come on, let's see you skim. Any good at it? How many skips have you accomplished? What's the Guinness World Record for jumps on a skimming stone? Do you know? Neither do I. Do you care? Neither do I. But you know, it's something that a dad has to do with his kids. It's part of being a dad, and you've got to do it. So you practice in the dead of the night when they're not watching. And Helen says, where are you going? I said, just, I'll be back, I won't be long. Okay, down there. You watch this, watch it. I'll show you my technique. Take a second. You've got to be back to Helen first. You bring the private secretary, doesn't he? Never stand. It comes from here. Right? It's not here. That bit comes later, but it starts here. Bring your arm back. Right? You've got to get the feet in the way. And then you bring the arm back. Come on, come. And you bring the arm back. And you go like that. Okay? Do you want to stand up and try? It's this, isn't it? Is it? Try that. Try the other one. That's why our Sunday schools are so important. And we shouldn't neglect the narratives, the great, stunning, dramatic narratives of the Old Testament scriptures. Here's God's youth facing God's enemy against all the odds, doing it with God's courage, in God's name, provided with five stones made by God in God's brook. Is it an accident that the five stones were there just when God's youth needed them? They've been crafted over years and years and years and years of God's rippling water running through that stream, and the day came when God's youth came up and picked them up. It was all planned. Goliath had no chance. Here he does it. Like a bullet. And he didn't need fire. First shot. I think it's fantastic. And the giant fell. Great courage. Great courage. What I like best is what he said to Goliath. Listen to this. Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down." Yes. What terrific confidence. And once I'm young. Sometimes, you know, we have more confidence in God when we're young than when we're old. Yeah. Sometimes we have the arrogance and the rashness of youth, which leads us into a sometimes cavalier attitude to the things of the spiritual life, but it manifests itself sometimes in this very clear-cut, black and white, straight out, unquestioned trust that God will do this thing. Need to hang on to some of those attitudes as the years tick by and not have the years soften them or water them down for us. Physical courage, sheer physical courage. This boy was given sheer physical courage to get out there and do this thing that day to the glory of God and the honor of his nation, the chosen people of Almighty God. Well, it led on to other things. We haven't got time to look at those, but I wonder if there's somebody in the meeting tonight who needs fresh courage and fresh hope. Do you need physical courage? Some of you live in dangerous places. Some of our cities and our towns are not safe places. And some of you going into public houses with Christian literature and army literature, you need physical courage these days to do that. It's always been that way. Always. We don't always get received gently. Sometimes we do, thank God, but not always. Sometimes people can be inebriated and give us a very, very hard time. And so I thank God for the courage of Salvation Army women who go into these places. Quite undaunted, and I just go on. On and on and on. I wonder if there's somebody here tonight who needs courage to speak or courage to witness. Do you remember Stephen in the Acts of the Apostles, the first Christian martyr? He stood and spoke for Christ, gave his life as a result. Stephen, courage to speak. And then what about our Lord himself in Gethsemane? Jesus came out and went, as was his custom, to the Mount of Olives, and the disciples followed him. And when he came to the place, he said to them, "Pray that you may not enter into temptation." And he withdrew from them about a stone's throw. Isn't that interesting that there's a stone mentioned there? And knelt down and prayed. And he said, "Father, if thou art willing, remove this. sometimes it's physical courage. Sometimes it's courage to witness. Sometimes it's courage to be obedient to God's will. I remember in 1978, we said back to the future. My wife and I were serving the war as officers in Africa, a country then known as Rhodesia. It's called Zimbabwe. In those days, it was a paradise. It was an exquisite place. It was beautiful to behold. It was wealthy. It was the breadbasket of Africa, as they called it. And on many of the farms, there would be harvests twice a year, so fertile and so well irrigated was the land. We had a school for girls in the southwest part of Rhodesia called the Usher Institute. And on a dark night in June 1978, terrorists entered that school and murdered two Salvation Army officers, both young women, Lieutenant Diane Thomas and Sister Sharon Smith Girls. Diane was from Shepherd's Bush and Sharon was from Northern Ireland. Logan, Bangalore. Well, they gave their lives, I think. Others were injured and shot in the melee. It fell to me to be the first at the school. We lived about an hour's drive away in the city of Bulawayo. We were the corps officers of Bulawayo, so the name Bulawayo means a place of kill. And at dawn's first light, I found myself on the school campus. We evacuated the girls in coaches, which we'd arranged to the night. Meanwhile, I'd identified the bodies of Cheryl and Diane in the back of the military vehicle, lying under a dirty military tarpaulin. I gathered up the essential files from the principal's office and said to Major Caldwell, "You'll come into town with us and stay with them." We've made arrangements for the other stuff. And some of the other mission staff were already in hospital. And in order to load up the principal's essential belongings and her key files, I had to go to the other end of the school and collect a Volkswagen minivan, which